stretched out wide, barely hanging on to life, left to suffer on your own. You came for all mankind to bridge the great divide, and somehow ended up alone. Because of all the blood and tears you shed, I will never know that kind of loneliness. Your spirit never leaves me. Even when I'm hurting, I don't have to bear that burden.
And it flows to the Lord. that gives me strength from day to day. It will never lose its power. It soothes all my doubts and calms my fears. Oh, and it dries all my tears. Oh, the blood that gives me strength from day.
Pretty good. We'll take that. I just want to make note of this real quick. We are housing our brothers and sisters from the Slavic Baptist Church here in town, and because their building burnt down. And so they asked us, they said, hey, can we decorate for our fall like a Thanksgiving? It's like a celebration of the harvest. Can we decorate for that? I said, yes, of course. And so just this is all fresh, all right? And their service is after ours, so please don't eat this. I imagine that would be a bit devastating if they came in and all their harvest is gone. So, but once again, it is a privilege that God has given to us to share what God has given to us. This building is not ours, right? It's the Lord's, and to be used for His honor and glory. And so it's a precious thing to be able to share that. I got several announcements, things that are going on in the life of our church family, so I'll try and rattle through these pretty quickly. I want to say, first of all, thank you for your prayers for Hannah and I. We left and went to a retreat conference, and we were gone for most of the week, and we sat underneath the teaching of a professor from a seminary in Cary, North Carolina, and he spoke on Leviticus 23. And when I first saw that, I thought to myself, oh boy, what in the world? Leviticus 23. Well, I can never, ever make fun of Leviticus again. He spoke through the feasts, and the seven Jewish feasts and how they are, it's a good help for us to understand the New Testament and the life of Jesus and what's going on. But it's really interesting when you get to the end with the feasts of the trumpets and the feasts of the booths, there are still things yet to be fulfilled. And so they were still looking for that day when those things will be fulfilled. And so it was pretty precious. And so anyways, it was just a blessing of a time. And then Hannah and I, on the way home, we took White Pass, which we never do because it takes way too long. And then we were going to go to the Grove of the Patriarchs. But then as soon as we realized it was right inside Mount Rainier, the park, and you had to pay to get in, then we drove all the way up to Paradise. And it was absolutely gorgeous. I mean, the day was beautiful. And so we were able just to wander around a little bit inside Mount Rainier and just be reminded of its beauty, and then to be in awe once again of the creator of such beauty. And so thank you for your prayers for Hannah and I and the time away we had, and for your part. Some of you had helped with watching the kids and different things, so thank you for that. Services in our church, things that we do here to minister to one another and to grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We have our Sunday service, which new starts at 9:30 with Sunday school, and or you can call it adult education, whatever you want to call it, because we have adult education and we have Sunday school, or you can have Sunday school and Sunday school. We have everything for old people, middle people, younger people, and youngest people. And so just teaching and training them in the Word of God, letting the Word of God run over us once again. And in the adult class, we're going through Ephesians. John is going to take us through Ephesians. And one of the things that stuck out in my mind this morning is that from the time the book of Ephesians was written, to the time in Revelation when they're mentioned, 30-some years perhaps, there's been a loss of their first love. How could it be that in 30 years they could go from rejoicing in their salvation to losing that first love and being distracted with other things? But then I thought, you know, about us. I wonder about us. Do we lose our first love? Have we lost our first love? Do we love Christ like the day we first believed, or have we grown cold? And so anyways, good thoughts from Sunday school. And so I'm thankful for that. And downstairs to see the kids holding up the songs and singing, and I'm rejoicing in that. So praise the Lord for that. So that's Sundays. And of course, then we have our morning service at 10:30. And then on Tuesday, we have Uplift Recovery Ministry, which starts at 6:30. It's really a Bible-based discipleship ministry to help people along in their journey to recover from hurts, habits, hang-ups, and to move on walking with the Lord, to give a good support base for them there, both in the Word and then just in fellowship. So that's Tuesday nights at 6:30. And then Wednesday morning at 9 a.m., there's a ladies' discipleship ministry, and then prayer meeting Wednesday night at 7 p.m. And ever since Tom Meyer came, we've been trying to promote memorizing the Word of God. And so we are rehearsing that on Wednesday night. People are telling us what they've memorized. And so we'll share that. Someone else said to me today, hey, I'd like to share on Wednesday night. And so we'll hear another verse memorized. And we should be hiding God's word in our hearts. One of the ministries that we are involved with and we want to be involved with is the Shoebox Ministry, Operation Christmas Child, which goes into all the world, these boxes, and presence in there, but also the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so Helen, who's organizing it this year and taking up the lead on that, she has an announcement, and so she'll give us the announcement this time.
First of all, I'd like to thank everybody who has donated things. We've got two tubs completely full, and we have a third one waiting for things. The things that we can use now would be pretty things to put in girls' hair. They love to have pretty things, so I'm going to make up some bows with clippies on them. I've got lots of inch-wide ribbon, and I just thought that would be something fun to do. Combs, hairbrushes, toothbrushes. We can't put toothpaste in, but we can certainly supply the brush for them. Washcloths, and I have a lot of bars of soap, so I think we're okay with soap. Another idea would be small flashlights, and then put in extra batteries. If you do put in anything that requires a battery, be sure to put in some extra batteries, because lots of times they don't have the way to get batteries to put in their things. We have a box downstairs full of McDonald's toys, but if you can think of any other little toy that you might want to put in, you can put those in the tub also. So I would just like to thank everyone who has donated, and I've just put a challenge out to you for some new things. And while I'm standing here, this Thursday, the ladies are going to meet upstairs. We're not going to sew. We're going to organize that room.
A good. Yes. Sure, you just hold it down. We had a prior agreement when that room was first invaded by the ladies. I said, here's the shelf. It all has to stay on the shelf. And it's been pretty good. It's been pretty good. But yeah, I know. okay, let me give you a few other things that are going on. Looking forward in the calendar, we have the chicken barbecue coming up October 1st. And so that's a week from Friday. It'll be around 6 o'clock in the evening. It'll be like a fellowship meal, be a celebration together. And as for us, we'll need some help as well, cooking the chickens and setting up the barbecue. And so we'll talk to you more about that next week. But just make sure you mark that on your calendar. And then also, October 14th is a ladies' lunch. And I told Donna, I said, Donna, that's like a month away. No one's going to remember it. And Donna said, no, we need to get the word out so ladies can start planning it so they can cancel all their doctor's appointments and make sure they have that cleared for the ladies' lunch. So that's October 14th. One of the precious things that we have that is not a direct command from the Word of God, but it is based on inferences from the Word of God, is church membership. Church membership, it is a blessing to my soul. It is an opportunity to help guard the truth, because you can't teach here on a regular basis unless you are a member. And so we go through a process of talking about doctrine to know you're on the same page. But it also helps us to practice things like church discipline. It lets us know who's involved and who's part of us. And we have a church covenant that is basically what we should be doing based on the Word of God. And it's a great covenant. But at the very end of it, it says this: moreover, we purpose that when we remove from this place, we will as soon as possible unite with some other church of like precious faith, where we can carry out the spirit of this covenant and the principles of God's word. Well, this happened recently. Jacob and Lana were members here for a while. Of course, Jacob's been a member here for a long time. And but they moved to Moses Lake, and they desire to be closer to a church. And so they have found a church in Moses Lake, and they've joined that church. And so he wrote a letter back to our church family, and I wanted to read it to you. It says this: as many of you know, Lana and I decided to look for a church that is closer to where we live in Moses Lake. We started the search process with open minds and prayerful hearts, looking to follow God wherever he called us. After viewing churches in the area, one of them stood out. We had initially gone just to cross it off the list and to say that we tried it out, but God had different plans. After the service, when Lana and I sat in the car, we turned to each other and almost said in unison, I think we found where God wants us. The clear and applicable preaching of the Word of God was what caught our attention. As we continued to attend, we felt more and more that God was calling us to Moses Lake Alliance Church. Since attending, we have been involved in getting to know the other church members through small groups, working in the sound booth and VBS. We have recently finished going through a membership class that goes over the church's history and explains what it means to be an effective biblical church member. In addition to that, Lana and I both recently have been approached for leadership positions within the church. All this to say, God is working in our lives and using us in ways we never expected. Praise and glory be to him. As the Lord is moving us in a new direction, we would like to request that our names be removed from the Soap Lake FBC membership list, as we have started our new membership at Moses Lake Alliance Church. We are so thankful for Soap Lake FBC and for the ability to pray, worship, and serve Jesus with you all. You always be family and dear to our hearts. We look forward to still visiting you all soon. In Christ, Jacob and Lana. And so that is very precious. Not very many people leave a church well. Over the time that I've been here, there's only been a handful of people that leave well. Usually people just disappear, and you have to go find them and say, hey, what's going on? And you get the roundabout until finally they get to it. Oh, and then they tell you. And so it's precious when people leave well, and they leave not just to leave, but they leave and go join another church. In this aspect, God does not want us to be orphans. He doesn't want us to be without a church. Every Christian is expected by the Word of God to be part of a church family. And that is what God expects us. And that's where we need to be. And so I rejoice in Jacob and Lana and their direction and how God is using them. In fact, I think they just recently started a WANA program. And Lana just kind of opened her mouth and said, "Hey, have you ever thought about a kids program on Wednesday nights?" And they said, "Okay, you do it." And so anyways, they're being used there. But as people go, people come. And recently, well, not recently, someone's been with us for a little while, Johnny Jackson, and he's been precious. We've gotten to know him, and he would like to join the church. And so I've investigated his testimony and doctrine. He's read our constitution, and he wants to be part of us in a formal way. So at the end of our service, we will formally vote on Johnny being part of the service. Now, I'd like to say, you know, sometimes, you know, there's people that come to church faithfully, give, and even serve who aren't members. And so, you know, you might say, well, what does that make me, a second-class church person, you know, because I haven't joined the church? No. But I think it is a step in the right direction of our growth and maturity with the Lord, is that we would commit to a local church, to be part of it, to financially be part of it, to pray with it, to uphold one another and know one another. So anyways, at the end of the service, if I remember, I have to put that in there because sometimes I forget. I get all excited about the message and then I forget. But at the end, we'll vote on having Johnny become part of our church family in an official way. Take your Bibles, please, and go to Ephesians chapter 4. I know that was a long introduction. Not only do we have the blessing of having Johnny formally become part of our church family, but also in just a few minutes, Andy is going to get baptized and we're going to hear his testimony. And so it's just neat to see things going on in the life of our church family. Ephesians chapter 1. Yes, Ephesians 4. Ephesians chapter 4. As I was reading this past week, and of course John will hit on this when he goes through here and work it out, but I was struck by the unity that believers should have. There seems to be not unity in the church today. There seems to be a lot of division, and it's not over doctrinal things. It's over preferences and practices, and it's unfortunate. Because we are brothers and sisters in Christ, and we are on the same team. If you have believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, then you have been washed by the blood of the Lamb. You've been adopted into God's family. You are indwelled with the Holy Spirit, and we are one together in Christ. And there, we may have differences of opinion, but that should never drive us apart. We must remember who we are in Christ. And so as I was reading this, I thought, man, this is great. We need to remind ourselves of this. I need to remind myself of this. And so let me read a few verses, and I'm going to skip a few, but just follow along. Ephesians 4, 1, "I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling which with you were called, with lowliness and gentleness, with long suffering, bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace." Those are beautiful words, aren't they? But hard words to practice. Lowliness is not natural to me. Pride is. And there's a few of you out there that are like me. We're more prone to pride than we are to lowliness, than we are to humility. Gentleness, long suffering. Patience is one of those things that God has to continue to work on us, right? Don't pray for patience, because you will get it. Patience, bearing with one another in love, sacrificing like Christ sacrificed. He loved us so much that he died on the cross for our sins. That is the sacrifice that Christ did for us. How far are we willing to sacrifice for one another? To what lengths are we willing to sacrifice, to bear with one another, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace, endeavoring to keep that unity? Are we working on that, praying for that, looking for that? There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. Moving down to verse 11. As we grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, he works in us to be working in one another. So he himself, Christ, gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, for the equipping of the saints for the work of the ministry. I believe it is not the task of the pastor to do the work of the ministry, but it is the task of the saints. It's the task of the church to do the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body in Christ, till we all come to the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, or to a complete man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we should no longer be children tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine by the trickery of men in the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up in all things into him who is the head, Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share, causes growth for the body, for the edifying of itself in love. The effective working by which every part does its share. If you've believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, Holy Spirit lives inside of you. He gives you gifts to do work here. Are you doing the work that God has called you to do here? Are you pulling your weight? I hope so. I hope I am, and I hope you are, because we don't want to be a church divided. We don't want to be a church tossed back and forth by every wind of doctrine or every opinion that's out there. You need to be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. We're here not to do my work and not to do your work, but to do the Lord's work. That's what we're about. Let's pray. Well, Father, it certainly is a blessing to be together under this building that you have given to us. We acknowledge that even though this is a comfortable place, Father, we could worship and gather anywhere. We could come together in someone's backyard, in someone's home, to be the church. And so, Father, I pray that we would recognize that this building is not the church, but we are the church. And the work that you have called us to do is not done by a few, but it's done by all of us. We all together as a body are to be abounding in your work, laboring fervently until you call us home. May we know the work that you have called us to do and to do it faithfully as a good steward. Father, whatever that work is, it may be in the area of teaching. Father, I'm thankful for our teachers. We've started Sunday school anew, and we have a whole bunch of new teachers. And I'm thankful for the labor of love that they are doing, the sacrifice that they are doing to study and to pray over those whom they are teaching. And Father, I pray that their teaching times would be effective, that you would use them in a great way, and that those under them would grow, and Father, grow to be teachers themselves. Some you've called in our church congregation, church body, to be teachers. Others to be givers, others to be comforters, others to be prayer warriors, and the list goes on and on. But Father, we must work. You've given each one of us a work to do, and we need to be diligently doing that. Father, forgive us this morning if we have cast off the work you've called us to do, or Father, if we have left our first love. May we be a people always in love with you. Father, we look around at our country, and Father, I am saddened by our churches. Many churches, I think, are distracted and are divided. Many believers are taking up sides on current issues, and it breaks my heart, Father. I think we've forgotten about the gospel. I think we've forgotten that we are all one in Christ. I think we've forgotten about our main purpose, why we're here. Remind us, may we here in this church assembly never forget. May we never forget why we're here. Father, thank you for each and every one that's here. I don't know the week that everyone has had. Perhaps it's been a joy-filled week with lots of blessings. Perhaps it's been a hard week with lots of pain. Father, perhaps the groaning is greater. Perhaps the longing for heaven has been more this week because of just the turmoil, the distress of the week. Father, I pray that you would encourage those this morning whose hearts are weary, whose souls, Father, are downcast. That they would call out to you. They would know that you hear them and that you will pull them up. May they never forget that you are their loving heavenly Father who is greater than any distress and who will never leave them or forsake them. May the truth of your presence and the promises of your word wrap around their souls and comfort their hearts. May they know you are their God. And Father, give them hope. Give them hope for their situation. Give them a right perspective. Give them the eyes, your eyes, to see what is going on. Father, I pray you would not only work here, but everywhere where our brothers and sisters are around the world. Encourage them. May they be faithful for you. Thank you for this morning. May it be, Father, not only a precious time, but may it be a time of growth and sanctification. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, Daniel is going to come and lead us in our singing. We're going to sing one song, and towards the end of that song, the curtain will open, and you'll see the baptism of Andy, and then we'll sing some more songs after the baptism. John's going to come up and pray for us.
Let's stand and sing. Let's see. Oh, I have a different one. 302. 302. Oh, up at the top. Oh, what that says. Thank you. Throw something at me next time. I was like, number two.
Thank you. I love coming to the baptismal tank. I love this command that Christ has given to us to be baptized. It's a visual demonstration of what has happened in a person's heart and mind when they have believed in the Lord Jesus Christ. We can't see that belief. We can hear the confession, but we get to see the baptismal. And when someone is baptized after they've believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, they go down into the waters. That signifies that they have died to an old life. And then they are, like Christ, they are raised to a new life. And it is a moment of dedication where one says, I am going to follow the Lord Jesus Christ. I am a disciple of Jesus Christ. I want the whole world to know. I'm not ashamed of the gospel. And so today we have the privilege of seeing Andy get baptized. And for me as a pastor, this is really, really precious. And he'll tell us testimony in just a minute. But Andy is the grandson of Ed and Cheryl Wilkinson. Ed and Cheryl were dear, faithful people in this church body. And this is one of the people that they faithfully prayed for. And so even though Ed's not here today to see Andy's baptism, it is a day that he prayed for and longed for, and I'm sure is rejoicing in. So I'll let Andy read his testimony, give his testimony, and why don't you move over here? The mic's a little closer, so.
All right. Good morning. I guess I'll just jump right in here. So Romans 3:11 tells us that there's none who understands. There is none who seeks after God. And this verse in particular always comes to my mind when I remember my life before knowing God. I know it was not through my own effort that I found God. He guided me to him. I was raised in and out of the church, and I've always had the gospel message available to me in my life. I can remember not really knowing what to make of it when I was very young, and as I grew older, my parents divorced, and I stopped going to church without ever seriously confronting the gospel. Around when I started going to middle school, I remember first considering Christianity's validity, but I quickly dismissed the idea. My friends and teachers at school told me that science does not line up with Christianity, and I bought into that blindly for a while. It was an easy and comfortable thing to tell myself and a way for me to live in rebellion. I do not know exactly at what point something changed, but eventually that old excuse wasn't enough for me. And I actually wanted to know for certain that Christianity was wrong. At the beginning of seventh grade, I began to read the Bible for myself, looking for a lie. But what I instead found was the truth. I came looking for a way to comfortably deny God and live my life free from the Bible's regulations, and what I instead found was the gospel. Over time, as I read the Bible, my goal shifted from trying to disprove Christianity to trying to understand the gospel message in itself. I still didn't believe it for myself, but I wanted to know exactly what it was so that I might believe it. It was around this time that I prayed one of my first genuine prayers to God. I only asked God to help me understand his word, if he is real, and I continued to read my Bible and pray that prayer. I didn't understand what I was reading for a long time, but I continued to read. Eventually, I began to put the whole story of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection together, and I wanted to see if it was true. I found that the Bible actually speaks to this issue itself. Peter tells us in 2 Peter 1:16, "For we did not follow cunningly devised fables when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of his majesty." When I realized the suffering that the apostles underwent to proclaim Jesus, I understood that the resurrection must be true. There's no other explanation for the events that took place. Initially, my belief was very flimsy, and even though I had believed the Bible was true, I did not immediately ask for the forgiveness of sins. It took a lot more reading and clumsy prayer for me to understand the state of sin and hopelessness in the world. I thought that because I believed Jesus existed, I was good to go, and I even started to fake a more religious life. I went back to church and got baptized in eighth grade, all the time continuing to read my Bible, but never truly confessing my own sins and truly repenting from it. Eventually, I stopped going to church again. I still continued reading, and I learned that I needed a savior and that the way I was living my life was leading me towards destruction. I decided finally to swallow my pride and admit my sin. I realized that I could not save myself, and my only hope was to place my faith on Jesus Christ's blood to save me. When I understood how badly I needed the sacrifice he made for me, I was cut to the heart. Knowing that there was no way I could hope to repay the price of my sin, I placed my faith in Christ for the first time in my life. After making this confession, I continued to read my Bible. I read more and more, frequently, and prayed constantly. But I was ignoring certain parts of the Bible that I read. I never returned to church throughout high school, despite reading about the importance of church in the Bible, and I never seeked to understand baptism either. This last school year, I went away to college at the University of Washington, and I found a group of disciples who taught me more about putting God first in my life. I finally started to learn about the importance of going to church and was considering getting re-baptized, but they also tried to teach me some incorrect doctrine and didn't work out with this church, sadly. They told me that it was possible for someone to lose their salvation and that a person isn't saved until they are baptized. At the time, I didn't know enough scripture to correct them, but I have made it my goal since then to put on the whole armor of God so that I can be fully equipped to spread the word of God. I also want to tell you a bit about my beliefs about baptism in particular. I believe that my baptism has been long overdue in my life. Even though I was baptized in 8th grade, I don't know if I really understood it or even truly believed back then. After that point, I lived much of my Christian life very independently and for a long time never thought about baptism again. More recently, I've been studying what baptism really is and what it represents. Scripture gives us lots of examples of how baptism should look. Throughout the book of Acts, we see new believers like Cornelius or the Ethiopian baptized as soon as they believe. And Acts 19, 1 through 5 even gives examples of rebaptism. And those verses say, "And it happened while Apollos was at Corinth that Paul, having passed through the upper regions, came to Ephesus. And finding some disciples, he said to them, 'Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?' So they said to him, 'We have not so much heard whether there is a Holy Spirit.' And he said to them, 'Into what then were you baptized?' So they said, 'Into John's baptism.' Then Paul said, 'John indeed baptized with the baptism of repentance, saying to the people that they should believe on him who would come after him, that is, on Christ Jesus. When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus.' Being baptized is clearly God's will for new believers, and he even explicitly commands baptism in Matthew 28, 19 to 20. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen." And God doesn't simply command us to do this without reason. Baptism allows us to identify ourselves with Christ's death as well as his new life. In Romans 6, 3 to 4, it says, "Or do you not know that as many of us as were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life." I think of baptism as being similar to a wedding. If you're getting married, you don't love your new spouse because you're now married, but because you're married, you now have identified yourself as loving your spouse, both to the world and to God. Baptism is similar. We identify ourselves as dead to this world, but alive in Christ, and we show our commitment to living our lives according to God's will. I've already committed myself to living my life for Christ, and now this act of baptism allows me to identify myself publicly with Christ.
Amen. Yeah. No, it's amazing testimony, and so we get the privilege of just being part of this and seeing this and. So we rejoice in that together. So Andy, I'm gonna move this right back here so it doesn't get wet. So we're going to stand right here, all right? So because you have placed your faith in Jesus Christ and you want to publicly identify with him within baptism, and because the church has commanded us to baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, we're gonna do that now, signifying dead to an old life, raised to a new life, okay? Amen. John's going to come and pray over Andy and pray for him. You know, Andy told me, he says, "It's going to be kind of weird getting baptized and then going off to college, you know, because you're not going to see me for a while." And I said, "That's fine. That's okay." And so be in prayer for Andy as he goes back to school this next week, and that the Lord would continue to work in his life. He would grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, that he would find a good church, get involved. And so, John, if you could please pray for these things.
Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this example of believers' baptism this morning, and we thank you for Andy and for his testimony. Father, we just thank you how you worked in his life, and we just pray that you will just bless him as he goes off to college here in this next week. We pray that you'll help him, like Pastor said, to find a new church and be able to grow in you and be a good example and testimony for you over there as he goes to school. Father, we just ask you to help each one of us to remember Andy in prayer as we go throughout this next year as well, to encourage him as he grows in you, and we pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. There was many things I wasn't taught in college, and one of them was how to be a quick change artist. Those songs were specifically picked out to guide our hearts and our minds towards the study at hand and where we are going to go for the next several weeks, probably the rest of the year. We're in September. And so we're going to go to the book of Revelation. The book of Revelation. Now, I talked with Paul Pierce this week, who is with Friends of Israel. And he goes around and he does different prophecy conferences. And he said to me, you know what, when I get somewhere, you can always identify the crazy people. The crazy prophecy people. It's like they're making a beeline for me. And you can just see them coming. You know, they've got their books, they've got their Bible. And I am thankful we don't have any crazy prophecy people here. We have people who love prophecy, and that's good because it's in the Bible. There's a lot of the Bible that's prophecy. In fact, this is a book of prophecy, if you will. And so my plan is not to go through the entire book of Revelation. Okay, and that's where you're like, oh no. So what are the seven this and the four this and the heady thing that has all these different horns? What about those eyeballs? And what, you know, all these questions we might have about the different things in Revelation. Really, my heart is to look at the seven churches in chapters 2 and 3 of Revelation, because I see it as a very needful instruction for the church today. And so that's going to be really where we're going to be spending the most of our time. But just so we don't feel totally ripped off at looking at Revelation, we will look at the first chapter, and then we'll look at the churches. And then we'll look at the last three chapters, which there's some amazing stuff in the last three chapters of Revelation 19, 20, and 21. So we will we'll look forward to that. I just had a blank. There is a 22. Last four chapters. Man, who added a chapter to Revelation when I wasn't looking? So that's the last four chapters of Revelation. Oh, man. All right, let me read to you the first 8 verses of Revelation. Of course, this will be a bit abbreviated this morning as we're almost out of time, but I do want to introduce this to you. So let me read these verses 1-8. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants, things which must shortly take place. And he sent and signified it by his angel to his servant John, who bore witness to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, to all things that he saw. Blessed is he who reads, and those who hear the words of this prophecy and keep those things which are written in it, for the time is near. John, to the 7 churches which are in Asia, grace to you and peace, from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the 7 spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler over the kings of the earth. To him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, and has made us kings and priests to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Behold, he is coming with clouds, and every eye will see him, even they who pierced him, and all the tribes of the earth will mourn because of him. Even so, amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, says the Lord, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. Father, thank you for this book of prophecy that you have left with us. Certainly, it is a book full of many curiosities, but Father, it is a book that can be understood, and it is a book that we should read and we should understand, and we should keep. Father, there should be great application for us. And so thank you for giving us this book. May our time in it be profitable. And Father, may we be reminded of these great truths. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so chapter 1 is the prologue or the preface of Revelation. Now, I'm not going to ask for a show of hands, But how many of you, when you read a book, you skip the preface? All right? Or the preface, however you want to say that, okay? The preface. How many of you skip that? You're good. What? You're good. You should be a good book reader. It's there for a reason, okay? You can skip the dedications, that's fine, but read the preface. And here, really, we're getting the sense of what Revelation is all about. Who's writing it? Where is it coming from? Who is actually giving it to the churches? And then who are the recipients, the churches? And so there's important revelation in here. And it starts off by saying the revelation of Jesus Christ. Even though this is a book, big book, it's a singular revelation. It's one revelation. It's one thing that's being revealed, even though there's many things to it. And so this is the revelation that is coming. And so a question is this a revelation about Jesus Christ, or is this a revelation given by Jesus Christ? Because within the text, both are permissible and possible. When you read this book, one of the most precious things that you will encounter in this book, more than the horns with the eyes and this and that, is your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. You will see him over and over and over again. John the Baptizer cried out, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." And do you know that in Revelation, which now we know has 22 chapters, 20, depends on your translation, 28 times you will see Jesus referenced as the Lamb. The Lamb, the Lamb, the Lamb. We will be introduced once again to Jesus. We will see him in all his glory and his splendor. And even as I read this morning, you saw some of the things. Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, the ruler over the kings of the earth. And if you want a good study, one just to really encourage your heart, read Revelation. And don't try and figure out dates and times and all that, but just read through Revelation and take notes, write down everything that is said about Jesus Christ, who he is, how is he described, when is he coming, what does he say? Even when you get to the churches in Revelation, one of the things in the first couple chapters, you'll see that the letters to the individual churches are started by some depiction of Jesus. He describes himself in some way to encourage and help the church. And I think church family, what we need more is to see Jesus. We need more of Jesus in our lives. We need to know the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. We need to know the one who is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We need to know the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the one who was and is to come. Our hearts need to be full of Jesus. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. I don't know about you, but I can get distracted with a lot of things. I'm a very distractible person. I see squirrels everywhere, and it's horrible. It's horrible. But I hope I never get distracted from seeing Jesus. I need Jesus when I wake up, throughout my day, and when I go to bed. There's a precious song in our songbook entitled, "Give Me Jesus." It talks about going through the course of life. I need Jesus Christ. And so as excited as you might get about prophecy, you know, someone says Revelation and your prophecy antennas go up. You're like, oh, yeah. When you hear about Revelation, what should really go up is your heart for the Lord Jesus. Oh, that book tells me so much about my Lord and Savior. So as this is the revelation of Jesus Christ, as it does reveal Jesus Christ, I think it is more so, it is revealing the message of God through Jesus Christ. Notice the rest of that verse, the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave to him to show his servants things which must shortly take place. So even though we see a lot of Jesus in Revelation, There is a message that's being revealed here. God is making something known. By the way, I'm so thankful for that. I hope that this is a precious treasure to you. Do you know how much we would know of God without this? We would have really no absolute truth. There's a lot of cults that are out there. There would be 1,000 more if there was no Bible. Here we have God revealing himself to us. And so in this book, we have God revealing himself to us, but we also have God revealing to us his plan. Do you know that we know the future? We know the future. It's right here. And so God is revealing to us what he is going to do. This is the future revealed not by man, but by God. God is the source of this truth. God is the source of this revelation. Aren't you glad for that? Can we get a good amen on that? Amen, right? The future. What's going to happen in the future? Boy, there's a lot of crazy things happening, even in Washington State. Right? And you wonder, what's going to happen in the future? What's going to happen next month? What's going to happen? What's going to happen? Well, I know what's going to happen. It's right here in this book. And it says here, these are the things that must shortly take place. Down in verse 3, it's these are the things which are written, for the time is near. The time is near. And you say, wait a minute, Pastor, wasn't Revelation written a long time ago? Wasn't that like 2,000 and some years ago that it was written? That is a long time. That's a long time. But one, we have to put it in perspective. You know how a kid waits for his birthday? Especially when they're younger. A day can seem like a long time. And then you talk to an older person, you say, how was your day? It flew by. I don't know where the time went. It's over. Where'd that month go? We're going to move into 2022 here pretty soon. You say, what? We just came into the new millennium. What's going on? It is true that time to God is different. 2 Peter chapter 3, they said, where's the promise of his coming? There were scoffers that rise up, say, he said he's coming, but he's not. Look, he's waiting. And it tells us that he is long-suffering. And it tells us that a day to the Lord is like 1,000 years, right? So time to the Lord is a little bit different. But I don't think that's the only explanation for this. I think perhaps a better explanation is that the church is always called to be ready for the return of Christ. For every believer throughout every century, the time of Christ has always been near. Ever since the cross, we've been living in the last days. We're living in the last days. We're waiting for this timetable to come about. We're waiting for Revelation chapter 4 and 5 to come. We're waiting for that. And it could happen at any time. There's nothing hindering the Lord from coming back. There's nothing that he said, I need to do this first before he comes back. He can come back at any time. And if you read Paul in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, he was looking for the coming of the Lord. And he says, then we who are alive and remain at the coming of the Lord. Paul was looking for it, expecting it. So this book is to help us know what is going to happen in the near future. The writer is John. This is the apostle John, the disciple whom Jesus loved. Brother of James, one of the inner three with Peter, was able to go into the inner circle where he saw the Mount of Transfiguration, was in the garden with the Lord Jesus, not praying like he was supposed to be, but sleeping. And he is the witness of Jesus Christ, he says here, who bore witness to the word of God, the testimony of Christ Jesus, and to the things that he saw. He is a good and faithful and true witness, John is. And this is given to the churches which are in Asia, verse 4. Now, this is Asia Minor. This is current-day Turkey. And when we get to the churches, you'll see a map of where the churches are or were, and we'll be able to identify them. Verse 11 gives us the details as far as the cities that they are in. One of them is Ephesus, and so if you want to go through the book, you can come to Sunday school at 9:30 and come through the book with that. But that is who is receiving this book, the churches. And what's interesting is that seven churches in Asia Minor are identified. There were more than seven churches in Asia Minor. Why were only seven identified? Was there only seven churches that had problems? No, because every church has problems, right? Amen? I mean, have you been around? You know, you're like, well, this church doesn't have any problems. Well, you just don't know us well enough yet, okay? We've got problems. No, the seven churches in Revelation kind of give us a good overall scope of telling us what the churches are like. It's the number of completion, what's happening, what goes on in the life of the church, almost as if everything is addressed that needs to be addressed. And so we'll get to that more when we get there. This, what is really cool about this book, verse 3, is that you are going to receive a blessing today. There's seven different blessings in Revelation, and this is one of them. And so there's a blessing to he who reads, and the sense is to reads aloud. He who reads Revelation, he who hears the words of this prophecy and keep those things which are written in it. Keep it. He doesn't want us just to be a hearer of the word, but a doer of the word. And so there is a blessing that's going to come to us just by being under the word of God and listening and hearing. The benediction is giving grace to you and peace from him who is, who was, and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne. Now, a lot of people have said, what are those seven spirits? And there's different thoughts, like they're archangels, or they're angels, or they're this, or they're that. Some of that's coming from Jewish literature, but probably the best thing is that this is a depiction of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit. And there's a couple other times that we'll actually come across this. And you say, well, that's a very odd way for the Spirit to be described. In fact, it's not described like that anywhere else in Scripture. And I would agree with you. It is an odd way for the Spirit to be described. And yet, this is an odd book. There's a lot of things in here that are different. And we'll talk more about this when we get to there. So we have the Holy Spirit, I believe, and then Jesus Christ. The first, we won't have time to get into these. You should dig into these. These are good. The faithful witness. You know, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. He is not a liar. Everything he has said is true. He has witnessed the Father. He has witnessed the truth, and he has brought it to us. It is true. He is also the firstborn from the dead, 1 Corinthians chapter 15. If Jesus Christ did not rise from the dead, then we are of most of men to be pitied. But Jesus did rise from the dead, and he has become the first fruits, the firstborn of those who will be raised. Because he has risen, we know that we will be raised as well. And he is the ruler over kings of the earth. God is in control. He is in charge. Never forget that. To him who loved us and washed us from our own sins in his own blood, and has made us kings and priests to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. And I just want you to notice this real quick. To him who loved us and washed us from our own sins. We were the sinners. But how were we saved? How were we made right with God? Through Jesus Christ's blood. His own blood. It wasn't the blood of somebody else. It was his blood that was shed for our sins. He has washed us. He has cleansed us. But not only are we like that now. Now we've also been made kings and priests to God. And we will rule and reign with him forever. Really, this kind of begins to take our eyes off of the earth and put our eyes on heaven. Takes our eyes off of our current predicament and makes us look a little bit more towards the future. He is the coming one, verses 7 and 8 tell us. Behold, he is coming with clouds. Do you remember when Jesus ascended into heaven after his resurrection? And there he is on the hill and the mountain, and the disciples they watch Jesus ascend into the clouds and disappear. And all of a sudden, there's some angels there. And they said, guys, why are you gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus who you saw will come in like manner. He will come back in the clouds. And why we may say, well, this is referencing Acts. You go back to Daniel chapter 7, verse 13 and 14, which references the eternal king coming in the clouds. This is a prophecy of old that will be fulfilled. Every eye will see him, even they who pierced him, talking about the Jews, and all the tribes of the earth will mourn because of him. Even so, amen. And we'll see more of that when we get to Revelation chapter 19. I am the Alpha and Omega. This is the first and last letter of the Greek alphabet, the beginning and the end, says the Lord, who is, who was, and who is to come, the Almighty. 7 to 8 times that word Almighty is used of Jesus Christ in Revelation. He is the Almighty One. He is the Almighty One. And if you want to see works of the Almighty One, you read Revelation. He is the Almighty One. Now, this is just a quick overview, and next week we'll get into the rest of this chapter. Let me ask you, this is the future of the world. Whose side are you on? Have you been washed in the blood of the Lamb? Didn't we sing that song, Are You Washed in the Blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? There's no other place, there's no other way to be right with God but through Jesus Christ. And you have one life to believe. He died for your sins. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? And are you looking for the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ? You know, I can get really sidetracked looking at what's going on in the world with the rulers here. But I should be more focused on the coming ruler who will make all things right. And to know that I am his child and I will be part of his kingdom, which righteousness and justice will dwell. Oh, that thrills my heart. That's what my heart needs to hear when I get depressed and mad looking at the news. I want to throw things at the TV. It's not the TV's fault. When I get discouraged with looking around at other people, what's going on? This proclamation, this doing, that, this. I need to look towards my Jesus. He pulls me out of despair. He's my coming King. Look to him. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word and the blessing of this book. It is a great blessing. It is a great treasure. It shows us so much of who our Savior is, and we rejoice in that. Father, may we be students of this book, not just the prophecy, but the entirety of it. And really give us grace as we go through the churches. Father, I think we are like some of the churches, perhaps, where we would say we are rich, we are godly, we are good, but maybe you would come and look at us and say, no, but you're poor. No, but you need to be healed. Father, as a church, may we grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior. And may we shine brightly in these last days, always looking for the coming of our precious Savior, Jesus Christ. We pray this in his name. Amen. Well, one last thing I'd like to do this morning is I want to have Johnny come up. Well, no, actually, don't come up, Johnny. So that's a little bit of old habit. Okay, so before COVID, we used to give the right hand of fellowship, okay? But we don't want to make anybody uncomfortable. So we don't want to, before I would force you, I would be like, you don't get no food here no more until you shake this person's hand. We don't do that anymore just because of COVID. So I don't want to make anybody feel uncomfortable. but we are going to vote on Johnny, and then after that, I would just like you to go and encourage him, welcome him to the church. Not only him, but also Jean and Marilyn, bye, who not too long ago joined our church as well. And so I'm thankful for these three, and I'm looking forward to how God is going to continue using them in our church and continue to strengthen us through them. So we have a motion from the pastor, because I've inspected Johnny, rigorously inspected him, and he has passed the test. And so I've communicated that to our deacons. And so with our motion, we'd like to set forth Johnny as to join our church family. And so after that, we need a second, and then we can vote on. Pete seconds that, okay, Pete Savage. And then all in favor of having Johnny join our church family and membership, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Good, motion carried. All right. So Johnny, let me pray. I'm going to pray for you three, and you're joining our church. But then do please recognize these three after church and rejoice in their membership. Let me pray. Father, thank you for Johnny. Thank you for Jean, Marilyn. Their desire to be part of this church in an official way. Father, that is a blessing to me as a pastor. I think it's really biblical for us to make that commitment. And Father, I pray that you would bless them in it. I pray that they would be used here for your honor and glory until Christ comes, that they would be found here faithful. Thank you so much for their love and devotion to you. Thank you for saving their souls. They three have individual testimonies, and they're different, and yet they're the same, because they were sinners saved by the grace of Jesus Christ, and we rejoice in that. Father, thank you for our time here today and the blessing of it. In Jesus' name, amen.